Okay, thank you very much, and thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak. I'm very excited to tell all of you about these things. So I want to tell you about a new dynamical system that we've been studying for a couple of years called tiling billiards. And I'm going to leave an example up on the screen to sort of burn it into your mind because I'm going to use it later. So here's the deal with tiling billiards. So tiling billiards. Is a dynamical system where a trajectory refracts through a planar tiling. And the refraction rule is that when you hit an edge, the trajectory is reflected across it. So. So if you have some tiling, like the square tiling, and you have some trajectory, starting here maybe, and it goes to there, it refracts across so that the angle of incidence equals the angle of refraction, just like that. So in this case, this guy would just keep going, it would get here, these two angles are now equal, and then it would close up. We call such a path periodic, of course. There's another kind of behavior that can also happen. If you start at some edge and you go across, now these angles are equal, and now this guy's just going to zigzag. And that guy isn't exactly periodic, but it's basically periodic, so we have a word for that. We call it drift periodic. Fair enough. So this combines two of my great loves, billiards and planar tilings. So it's interesting in its own right, but I want to tell you why we started thinking about this, like why you would ever want to do this. Okay. So the motivation comes from a discovery in physics of materials with a negative index of refraction. So this comes up in something called Snell's law, which you probably remember but haven't seen for a while. So if you have two materials, such as like air and water, and you have a light beam that passes from one to the other, when it hits the boundary, it refracts, something like this. So, and then if you usually draw in the normal, you measure this angle, call it theta 1, and this angle, oops, not that angle, this angle, and call it theta 2. And if these materials have indices of refraction k1 and k2, then Snell's law says that sine of theta 1 over sine of theta 2 equals k1 over k2. Okay, so that's Snell's law. In standard materials like water and glass and air, these indices of refraction are always positive. So if this beam of light is traveling from left to right, it just keeps traveling from left to right. On the other hand, people conjectured in the 60s, and then this was actually found in the early 2000s, that materials exist with a negative index of refraction. So these are called metamaterials. And these have a negative index of refraction. So their index of refraction is negative. So then if a material were passing from some sort of standard material to a material with a negative index of refraction, well, it would come in like this with its angle. And then it would go back that way. And if you choose it so that this has refractive index k1 and this one has equal and opposite refractive index, then these two angles are equal and opposite. This is great. What? Did I get it right?
You have a metal material where K1 is minus K1 for some normal material?
Well, I think it's much easier to find standard materials. So if you created a metamaterial, you'd measure its net index of refraction, and then you'd create some sort of glass or plastic or something that had the equal and opposite index of refraction. My understanding is that these are hard to produce, they're expensive, so we're not actually going to get chunks of them, but we can imagine what would happen. So you can see this is just like billiards. If you imagine this normal is a wall, this is exactly the billiard law. And so we'll just measure that, in fact, the angles to the boundary are equal because that's easier than measuring to the normal. Okay, so this system is exactly the tiling billiard system. I should say that what I'm going to talk about is joint work with three different groups of people. The first part is joint with Kelsey DiPietro, Jenny Rusted, and Alex St. Laurent. These are undergrads who I worked with in the summer at ICERM RU in 2013. The most of the talk is joint work with Paul Baird Smith, Elijah Fromm, and Suman Iyer, who are also undergraduates that I worked with last summer. And then the last part of the talk is joint with Pat Hooper, who many of you know. Right. Yeah. Okay. Good. So I'm going to talk about a couple of different tilings. But I want to start by telling you about one of the really important techniques. And to do that, we'll just look at a really simple tiling. So a theorem, which I guess was the first group. So is that if a tiling is reflection symmetric across every edge of the tiling, then everything is periodic or drift periodic. Basically, everything is periodic if you consider those both to be periodic. So I'm telling you about this because we're going to use a powerful technique, which is called folding. So this is the analog of unfolding, which is used to turn polygonal billiards into flat surfaces, as most of you know. Tiling. A tiling of the plane is a dissection of the plane into regions. Doesn't have to be periodic. The boundaries don't have to be lines. The pieces don't have to have finite area, but we're going to talk about ones that are created by lines and do have finite area, triangle tilings and another tiling. So tiling, like there's a tiling, right? Okay. So if you have, So the idea is that if we have, let's say we have a tiling that's reflection symmetric across every edge. So for example, the equilateral triangle tiling, and it keeps going like that. Okay, so let's say we have some trajectory. It starts somewhere, say here, and then it goes to somewhere else, say here. Well, then it keeps going, and the angle of incidence equal to the angle of refraction, so it keeps going. And because the tiling is reflection symmetric across every edge, it does the same thing in this polygon as it did in this polygon. So as you can see, we have the trajectory going from here to here, then it does the same thing here, and if you fold it, the pieces of trajectory lie exactly on top of each other. And that, since the tiling is reflection symmetric across every edge, we can just reflect this across, 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 and the thing closes up. So for tilings that are symmetric like this, because of folding, everything closes up. Or if it's something like the square tiling, where you have parallel edges, then it just does a zigzag. So this only covers, there's only five tilings like this. Equilateral triangles, isosceles right triangles, 30, 60, 90 triangles when you do it by reflection, squares, and regular hexagons. But this is the technique, folding. Okay, so here. There are audiovisual aids, you can pass them around. Okay, so that concludes the part that's joint with these people. So I want to tell you about triangle trajectories in general. We're going to relate trajectories on triangle tilings to interval exchange transformations. So I want to give you some sort of intuition for what's going on. So we have this program that simulates tiling billiards. This program was written by Pat Hooper and Alex St. Laurent. So here's what it does. We imagine that we start a laser like this one at the green point. And we shoot the laser toward the red point. So I'll leave the green point where it is, and I'll move the red point around. You can see how it changes, yeah? Okay, and now since dragging and dropping with my mouse is a little bit imprecise, I have this button, and if I press this button, the red guy runs up the screen. Can you see it running up the screen? Okay, and then we can get another tiling. This tiling is called the Kazuarafi tiling. Thank you. Okay, so you can see that there's sort of interesting dynamics. Okay. So maybe you can see already that some cool things can happen. So this is how our program works. Now I'm going to show you a triangle tiling. So here's an example of a triangle tiling. I chose the angles in these sort of randomly based on my birthday. It doesn't really matter what they are. So again, we start at the green point and we shoot towards the red point. So I'm going to just move the red point around. You can see what happens. So maybe that one was interesting. Oh, look at that. Oh. Somewhere here. Yeah, so you can see that we get different things. All right. Somewhere here, there's a very big one. That one's pretty big. Oh, there we go. Okay, so if I have something like this, yeah. Somewhere here, there's a very big one. Okay. Okay. So this one, for example, is going to be very big. So we can kick up the iterations. Man, and it's not even done yet. So this is going to be some sort of periodic thing. Large periodic thing. Big, huh?
This is not reflection symmetric, right?
This tiling is not reflection symmetric. This is a 85-27 something triangle. It's sort of an arbitrary triangle. Yeah. So those are the only five tilings that are reflection symmetric. So I hope...
What is that? Can you remember the computer where you had a window open
all the time,
like this, you
put
in a number?
Oh, this one, I set the number of iterations. So how many, to make it go further. It wasn't drawing the whole picture. I can make it, I just don't want to crash my browser, because I have my, you know, some other stuff in the other browsers. And it takes a while. We won't be able to move it around. There we go. Okay. I don't know even if it's done yet. So anyway, so my purpose for showing you this is to come up with a couple of observations. So. Okay, so here's some observations. Okay, so you might have noticed that when I was moving the red dot around, things changed, but sometimes they didn't change. They just only changed a little bit. So things were pretty stable. Stable under perturbation of the starting angle. And also, everything seems to be periodic. No matter where we put this thing, it's periodic. Different periods, maybe bigger, smaller, but they're periodic. So we'd like to understand this. So this was the state of the art at the end of my work with these three students. We were able to prove some things, but mostly we just observed that things were happening and wanted to know why. Okay. Now, one thing that most people say, people like you say about this is, Well, can't you just reduce this to regular inner billiards? So I'm going to say why this is a bad idea. So okay, so the idea goes something like this. Okay, fine, you have your triangle. I'm going to draw a right triangle only so that we can tell which angle is which. Okay, and you have a trajectory going through your triangle, maybe something like this, okay? And then it reflects, whatever, across your edge. And people say, oh, well, we can reduce this to inner billiards. Surely we can reduce this to inner billiards. Huh. Well, one way to do it, well, if you want this to be inner billiards, you want to be able to reflect the tiling across an edge. And in order to do that, you're going to have to flip this triangle over. So I'm going to draw this triangle again. And then if you flip this triangle around and put it in there, this trajectory goes down here. And then this part, it was near the big angle, right? So it's here, and it's going to go like that. Okay. Okay. I don't know about you, but I don't really think things have gotten easier here. So, I'm not sure. You can do this, but I'm not sure that it's better, because you have to have some crazy rule where when you get to an edge, you sort of go to the symmetric point on the other end of the edge. Okay, so this is a reason why you might think, like, maybe I'll get stuck if I try to reduce this to inner billiards. But the big reason to not reduce it to inner billiards is that actually tiling billiards is simpler. So we'd be making it more complicated by bringing it to inner billiards. So I'm going to tell you why tiling billiards is actually simpler. There's a wonderful invariant that we get. Okay, so now this is work with these students. So here's some things that are true. So when you have a trajectory in a tiling and you reflect across, you fold across an edge of that tiling, the pieces of trajectory sit on top of each other. Okay, so. So I demonstrated that with the triangle that's going around. And you can also see it from any of the other pictures, that if you fold it across, the pieces of trajectory go onto each other. The next thing is that when you fold across a shared edge in triangle tiling, the triangles share a circumcenter. Okay. So this is going back to like Euclidean geometry, something we probably haven't thought of for quite a while. But it's true. So if you have some, I'll draw the circle first, and then I'll put a triangle in it. So in the tiling billiards, we have two triangles that make a parallelogram. In general, parallelograms are not inscribed in circles. But when we fold across, we get these two triangles, which are inscribed in the same circle. Yeah? So it works. Yeah. And you can think about the circumcenter is the intersection of the perpendicular bisectors to the edges. These guys share an edge. Therefore, they share a perpendicular bisector to this edge, and the circumcenter is going to be the same distance along that perpendicular bisector for both of the triangles. Okay, so this is a simple observation, but it's one that's really powerful. And this extends globally. So,
is this a triangle
just a triangle phenomenon. So I'm talking about triangle tiling. So, I switched to all triangle triangles tilings all the time. This is the triangle tiling portion of the talk. Any triangle. Oh, yeah. So, okay, I should say what I mean by a triangle tiling is exactly this sort of triangle tiling, where you pick a tiling triangle, and then you tile in this particular way. So you can think of it as being an affine transformation of the regular triangle grid, for example, or a grid of parallelograms that all have parallel diagonals, for example. So this is what I mean by a triangle tiling. It's really the best way to tile if you have non-special triangles. Okay, so amazingly, you can actually do this. So if your triangles are obtuse, you can fold along every edge of the tiling, and the thing folds up into a circle. If you have acute triangles, it still works, but you can't physically do it with paper. You'd have to sort of cut and do it one at a time, because globally they sort of run into each other. But you can actually do this. So I have this one. I have this one. They fold up into these triangles. And I have some pieces of paper here if you guys would like to try. So I'll pass these around. They're all obtuse triangles. Fold one way, like mountain folds, along the long side, and fold the other way, like valley folds, along the short sides. So this extends globally, so we can actually get all of our triangles inscribed in the same circle, which is really, really awesome. So I want to actually show you how this happens. Okay, so but two more observations. So if we consider, I'm going to talk about like blue triangles and red triangles. You can notice that all the blue triangles are oriented the same way, and all the red triangles are rotations of them. So we just pick our favorite orientation. My favorite orientation is going to be the blue triangles. So in the folded state, all the blue triangles are rotations of each other. So I want to show you this, how this works. Because this is a piece of paper on which I have drawn this exact tiling. That's why I left this up here, so it would be burned into your mind what it looks like. Because this piece of paper is small and this room is big, I have prepared some pictures. So here's this, and I'm going to fold along every edge of the tiling. So it sort of folds up like this. And if we keep going, we can fold it all up into a circle. Now, along the edge, you can see that all the pieces of trajectory lie on a single line. We said this before, but now you can really see it in real life. Additionally, all the blue triangles ended up on one side, and all the red triangles ended up on the other side. Cool, right? So all the blue triangles, for example, are rotations of each other in the circle, because they all had the same orientation, and then we folded and they stayed on the top. Nice, very nice. So that's the idea. So all the blue triangles are rotations of each other, and this reduces the system to a one-dimensional system. And so then we can make an IET out of it. So this trajectory being in one place is the invariant of the system that makes it better and easier than inner billiards. So this is why we wouldn't want to reduce this problem to inner billiards, because it's actually easier. Yeah, okay. So you can have a look. All right, great.
Sorry, I don't understand what the one-dimensional system is.
So now I'm going to explain that. So let's just consider three triangles here, and then we fold across each of the edges that are shared by triangles that you can see. So I left the top blue triangle where it is here, and then I folded across this edge the red triangle onto it, so that became this one. And then I folded this edge, and this blue triangle ended up here. So you can see in this picture that the two blue triangles are rotations of each other. And then we can just keep track. We can pick a favorite vertex of the blue triangle, let's say the obtuse angle, and then we can keep track of where it is on the circle. And that's our one-dimensional system. You just keep track of where your favorite vertex is on the side. On the circle. So it's an IET on the circle. Some people define IETs on the circle, and it's sort of abstract. But I'm defining it on the circle, and like you can see that you're passing around the circle. It's a real circle. It's defined on the circle. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm going to turn this into an IET. But first, I'm going to tell you some things that we can prove without using the technology of IETs. Just using this folding technique. So,
can you explain what is the IET? How do you choose across what to fold?
Right. You choose based on the edges that the trajectory crosses. Yeah. So we are going to have a trajectory in there too.
So for each trajectory, you get a different IET. For each direction, the trajectory, you get a different IET.
Yes. You fix a triangle tiling, and then you pick a trajectory, and for those, you get different IETs. Exactly. Exactly. So I'm going to develop the IET, but first I'm going to show you something that we can do just with the folding. So this is a theorem we proved last summer. So just from these folding techniques, we can get the result that a trajectory crosses a given triangle at most once. So if it, basically this means if it comes back to the same triangle, it's gonna do the same thing again. And we can get this by folding across edges and such. So this is a very powerful result. One thing you can say is, because it's always the same line in the triangle, in the circle. Yep, you're always the same distance from the circumcenter, all of that stuff. Exactly. So one thing is that if your trajectory doesn't escape, then it must be bounded, so it must get back to the same triangle, so it has to be periodic. So a non-escaping trajectory is periodic. On the other hand, if your trajectory isn't periodic, then it must escape. That's just the contrapositive. Okay. So a non-periodic trajectory escapes. So we're going to use this later to justify that we're going to use the Arnaud-Yocotes IET and say it's non-periodic, and just say that's because it's non-periodic, we know that our trajectory escapes. So we're going to use this later. Okay? And two more things. Every periodic trajectory is a simple closed curve. So no self-intersections. And finally, there are no dense trajectories. Certainly, because you can only cross every triangle at most once. But this isn't true of every tiling. I'm going to show you an example later where we get dense things. And we wondered why do we never get dense things in the triangle tilings? Well, because you can only cross each triangle at most once. So this is a powerful theorem. It's pretty simple, and it has all these powerful results from it. Yeah. Okay. So, So I'm going to turn this into an IET, and I will draw that now. No. Okay. Okay. So we have some triangles in our circle. Say these three. And this guy. And this guy. Okay, this guy is blue. This guy is blue. And we have a trajectory that goes across them. So maybe something like this. So I knew it had to cross this edge and this edge, because those are the edges that we folded across. Okay, so we keep track of where this vertex is. So this is, I got the wrong vertex? Oh, sorry. Yeah, because this triangle is the red triangle. The other triangle is the red triangle. Okay. So we create a free IET on the circle with every interval flipped. So it's completely flipped. I have a picture of what it looks like. So we have the angles of our triangle are alpha, beta, and gamma. So alpha, beta, gamma. The lengths of our intervals are 2 alpha, 2 beta, and 2 gamma. And what those numbers mean is those are the angles of the circle that are subtended. If this angle is alpha, then this angle here subtended is 2 alpha, and so on. So we get 2 alpha, 2 beta, and 2 gamma. And then the angle subtended by this trajectory that cuts through, we call that tau, because it's a trajectory. So what you do is you flip every interval. So that's what this is supposed to suggest. You take this interval and you flip it over. Take this one, flip it over, take this one, flip it over. And then we shift over by tau. So that's how it works. Some people...
Tau is the
angle subtended by the trajectory. The central angle in the circle is subtended by the trajectory. Yep. So basically what this IET does is it keeps track of where our special identified point is on the circle, and just this is what we get, 3 IET. It's a flip, IET with flips, it's a completely orientation reversing IET.
Oh, okay, then you have a question.
Yeah, exactly. So we have this completely orientation reversing IET. And we get different ones for different trajectories. So we can actually stack all these IETs and make them into a polygon exchange transformation, where each horizontal slice of this polygon exchange transformation is an IET. And so we take these pieces, the way the polygon exchange transformation works is we take these pieces and we rearrange them like that. So these are the same pieces, just rearranged. And if we draw in a single picture, here they are. And what happens is that if you look at the top corners of the triangles of the parallelograms, this blue parallelogram goes so that its corner is there. The pink one goes so its corner is there. The orange one goes so its corner is back here, and so on. We stack the IETs on top of each other, so this. Is an IET, and these pieces go exactly to these three pieces. So this polygon exchange transformation is for a fixed choice of triangles, so a fixed choice of alpha, beta, and gamma. So that determines these vertical lines here. And then your trajectory tau says where you are on here. So it's all the families of different IETs for different trajectories.
Fixed tiling.
You have
two dimensional space between a point and a direction. So
exactly.
It's a one dimensional variation. So what's.
Are these parallel trajectories?
They're not parallel. It's a one-dimensional family of IETs.
What's the one-dimensional?
This is the trajectory angle, the central angle subtended by the chord of the trajectory.
Is it the point and evaluate the angle in the tandem? Or what do you do? How do you get the family of IETs?
So the family of IET, you fix a tiling, alpha, beta, and gamma, and that fixes the pieces here, all the pieces. And then you, or the horizontal, how big the horizontal pieces are. And then you choose where your trajectory is, how big your chord is. And that says what slice you're on. And so based on, So you could imagine that you have a chord here. There's a trajectory that has some subtended angle tau. And over here, well, you could be over here instead with the same tau, right? There's two different places where your chord could be. And that that says where you are across, where your starting point is on the IET.
So in the original tiling, there are a lot of different orbits that get the same picture of the same flip IET.
Yeah, right, because you could start at a different point of the orbit. So this gives us a PET. Great. So one thing we could do is we could square our three IET on the circle with flips, and we could get a six IET on the circle without flips. Orientation preserving six IET on the circle. I don't know about you guys, but I have a favorite six IET on the circle, which a couple of people have already talked about today. So we can get the Arnoux-Yukos IET. So the tiling billiards associated to the Arnoux-Yukos IET. So to get the Arnoux-Yukos IET, you let x be the real solution to x plus x squared plus x cubed equals 1. And then you can create an IET. The way that we create the tiling billiards that is associated to it is we let our angles of our tiling be pi times 1 minus x over 2, pi times 1 minus x squared over 2, and pi times 1 minus x cubed over 2. And then we have to choose the tau equals pi. So this is a trajectory on this tiling that goes through the circumcenter. So this angle is about 41 degrees, this one is about 63.4, and this one is about 75.5 degrees. Just so you know what it looks like approximately. So we fix this tiling, and then we try to send a trajectory right through the circumcenter. And I want to show you what we get. So here is the triangle. Maybe you can see it has approximately 41, 63.4, and 75.5 degrees. We start our trajectory in a certain direction, and we get some stuff. So now I'm going to zoom out so you can see what we get. Okay, and my red point is somewhere. We can try to send our trajectory right directly through the circumcenter, but it's imprecise with pixels. So I'm going to move the red point around and we can see if we can get anything better. Oh. Yeah, it's better. Okay. Yeah, that's the idea. So the that, yeah, if we were able to get it exactly through the circumcenter, then certainly the Arnoux-Yokoats IET, there are no periodic points, so it could not be periodic. So it's non-periodic, and therefore it escapes. Yeah, neat, huh? So Pat Hooper happened to be visiting, and he said, why don't you try to find the Arnoux-Yokoats IET? Maybe you'll get the Rosy fractal. And we did. Yeah. We can't get a space-filling curve because every trajectory... Sure. We're not sure if it would fill up the whole plane or if it would just fill up some fraction, but we certainly think it gets bigger and bigger. Right. Certainly escapes. Maybe in all directions at the same time, maybe not. Yeah. Okay. So we can... these are the fractals. We have seen one of these pictures actually already today. Sorry that the picture is not so good. But these are Rosy fractals, Pierre Arnoux's Rosy fractal, Kurt McMullen's beginning of a Rosy fractal, and then Pat Hooper and Barak Weiss's Rosy fractal. So we get something similar. So if we start with very small, this is screenshots from our program. So if we start with the same triangle, but we have a very small one, and then the next one, then the bigger one, and you can see they get bigger and bigger, and as they get bigger, they approach the Rosy fractal. If you look going across, you can see they're sort of in families, making these three shapes. And these are Fibonacci in the following sense, that two of them add up to the next one. So this, so the colors aren't showing up so hot, but this one shows up right here, if you can sort of see it. This part is right here, and then this part is right here. And the same thing is true for the next one. This one is the sum of this, this, and this, and so on. You can just literally put the pieces together, and they get bigger and bigger. This is pretty cool. Yeah?
Do you get other parameters where you have an infinite trajectory? Mm-hmm. Other values at alpha, and gamma where you know that there's an infinite trajectory?
We have not worked on it, but I think so. By the way, we sometimes get drift periodic trajectories that escape, and then they're escaping. Yeah, okay. Good, very good. Okay, so that is that tiling. I want to tell you just about one more thing, which is the triangle hexagon tiling. So we'll just simulate it first so you can get some verisimilitude of this sort of thing. So this is now going to be joint work with Pat Hooper. So the triangle hexagon tiling is the tiling where a regular hexagon and an equilateral triangle meet across every edge. And life is very different on the triangle hexagon tiling than it is on the triangle tilings. So for instance, here's what we can do. We can move this around. Check that out, huh? Life is very different. And in fact, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to kick up the iteration so you can see life really is very different. So I'm just nudging the red point just a tiny bit. And we're getting all these things. Neat, huh? Okay, so hopefully you can see from this that life is very different on this tiling than it is on the triangle tilings. So here are some observations we can make about this tiling. So things tend to be unstable. As you can see, when we move the point just a little bit, everything changes a lot. And then things actually seem to be dense in some places. Yeah, like that. Right? It looks like it might be densely filling in certain regions. So this is in direct contrast to the triangle tilings where things were stable and periodic. So Pat and I were able to prove these things. We showed that, so there are actually drift periodic and periodic things on this. As you can probably see that you could get, you can guess that you can get periodic stuff. You can also get drift periodic stuff. So we proved that periodic and drift periodic directions are those in the triangle lattice, the equilateral triangle lattice, or the Eisenstein lattice if you want to give special names to things that don't need them. Yeah, and so we said exactly actually where these come from. So this is a trajectory. This is some general behavior on this sort of thing that happens. But we figured out exactly what happens. So if you make these concentric hexagons in your Eisenstein lattice and you just choose the visible points, so the places where a direction appears for the first time, then the periodic directions are all the hexagons that are a distance from the origin equivalent to 1 or 2 mod 3, and the drift periodic directions are on every third hexagon. So periodic is hexagons equivalent to 1 or 2 mod 3, and drift periodic equivalent to 0 mod 3. So we can say exactly where these things occur. And then for directions that aren't in this lattice, trajectories are dense everywhere outside of triangle centers. So maybe you can see this is a trajectory at slope 1. And you can see that these like little triangle centers are not hit. They're never going to be hit. There's sort of a periodic family of triangles that is never hit. But we hit everything else densely. So trajectories in every other direction are dense outside of triangle centers. These are not, by the way, the entire triangle. They're sort of a little tilted triangle inside, and the size of it depends on the direction of the trajectory. Good question. If you start right in the in the middle of the white triangle, I'm guessing it would hit a vertex at some point. Maybe not. If you start right in the middle, you can hit everything. Certainly, the closer you are to the middle, the less is missed. I hadn't thought about the middle.
So the tilt of the triangle is something.
Yeah, the tilt of the triangle depends. So in this tiling, trajectories only go in 6 different directions. And three directions in any given polygon. So that's how you get it. Yeah.
And this results, you didn't say, you fix a direction which is not a periodic direction.
Yes.
And then is it every trajectory or almost every?
Almost every, yeah. Almost every. I mean, we think it's just all the non lattice directions.
Okay, and then you have you're in almost every set of other directions, and all the orbits in that direction are almost every again. I mean, on the starting point. I mean.
Every, I believe it's every. We wanted to get every. Certainly, with existing results, we could get almost every, and so we thought that the non almost every were going to be these periodic directions. Yeah. Yeah. Good. And the way that we proved this was by creating an infinite translation surface. So I will say how this is done. So this is dramatic foreshadowing. Okay, so we start with the triangle hexagon tiling. Here it is. And then we dissect our hexagons into, let's see, which one is it? That one. Into rhombuses. Okay, these are just imaginary lines. They don't have anything to do with the trajectory. So now if we have a trajectory passing through this, let's say it does something like, okay, now it's going to reflect through there, and it sort of goes into there. Okay, the awesome observation is that if we foliate these rhombuses, sort of like these guys are friends. So if we create a foliation like this, and then a foliation like this, parallel to the trajectory, what you can notice is if you take this rhombus and you just forget about this part, and you move it up to here, the trajectory will go straight through. Yeah, and they also have a friend who is down here. So what we do to make our surface is that we cut up the whole plane into these rhombuses, and then we glue like that. And we create an infinite translation surface. So that is what this picture is. All the little families of rhombuses that we glue. So for each of these, we glue in this way. This edge to there, this edge to there, and this edge to there.
What are the colors?
The colors mean that like all the purple guys are glued to each other, all the yellow guys are glued to each other, all the blue guys are glued to each other.
And then the rest of the blue ones are the ones that are already in the plane. Right? The blue guy that's adjacent to a gray guy is just glued to it in the infinite translation.
That's right, yeah. Yep, exactly. So this is how we do it. We create an infinite translation surface. So. Which is a cover 3, which is a cover of 3 rhombi attached end to end. Sort of like this. Yeah, that's the idea. So the idea here is that, so I wanted to show you that there are these two different kinds of tilings, triangle tilings and the triangle hexagon tiling. They are both really interesting. They exhibit different behavior, really different behavior. The triangle tilings are periodic and stable. The triangle hexagon tiling is unstable and dense. We can analyze both of them, but we ended up using very different techniques. We can use IETs to do the triangle tilings. It's a one-dimensional system. On the other hand, we used translation surface, infinite translation surface, to do the triangle hexagon tiling. So some things remain to be done. So, some things to do. We could try other tilings. There are infinitely many tilings. And tiling billiards depend on angles, and so affine equivalence doesn't do anything for us. So every tiling gives a new thing. There are so many more tilings. Who knows which ones will be interesting? We would like to try some more. My burning question is, what feature of these tilings creates the periodic or stable versus the dense and unstable? So, for instance, if we could find sort of a smooth way of transitioning between triangle tilings and the triangle hexagon tiling, which there are, and investigating what happens in between, where the jump occurs, something like that, that would be really great. I don't know what feature it is of it that makes this happen. All right, thank you.